Good morning and welcome to another Frinton Gospel Chapel online. Unless you're watching this later in the day, in which case, good afternoon and or good evening. What if you're watching this really far into the future though? Hey, nice spaceship. Anyway, wherever you are, whenever you are, you're welcome. Let's just open with a prayer, shall we? Lord Jesus, even when we can't be together physically, I just thank you so much that we can be together spiritually with you. And I just pray now, Father, that all the distractions of the world will be left behind as we focus and we rest in your presence. Amen. Let's worship.
Nothing is impossible for you. You're the God of miracles, risen and abundance flow, blessed be your name. And blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place. Though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, and the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on the road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. And every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. You give and take. Say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Oh, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your amazing power and work in our lives. Thank you that you are able to bring us hope and peace amidst these difficult times. Lord, we lift up our church leaders and our governments to you, Lord. Help and bless them with the discernment and wisdom necessary to rebuild our country and our churches in a manner that pleases you, Heavenly Father. Help us also to protect our NHS, and help us as a nation, Lord, to draw closer to you. And as a people to draw closer to you, Lord. Please bless and help those suffering, either spiritually, physically, mentally, financially, or in any other way, Lord. Help us to remember, Heavenly Father, not to be afraid, for you are our God and you are with us. and you will strengthen us and you will help us. Above all, you will never leave us nor forsake us. Finally, Heavenly Father, please help us to always remember to hope in you, Lord. And in doing so, you will renew our strength. And we will soar on wings like eagles, and we will run and not grow weary, and we will walk and not be faint. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
This morning we're reading from Philippians 2, verse 6. Who, being the very nature of God, did not consider himself equal with God, but made himself nothing, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on the cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and let every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As we come to communion this morning, let us consider what we're doing, that we realise that we are acknowledging that Jesus Christ is Lord. And as we take the bread and the wine, let us remember these things. For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it, and in remembrance of me. For even if you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Father, we thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you for your poured out blood and for your broken body. And we give thanks this day for that sacrifice for us, to redeem us back to you. Thank you, Father. Amen.
Good morning, children. Hope you've all had a lovely summer. As it's now coming to an end and you might be thinking about going back to school, I thought I'd like to read you a story that I read to my class. It's a Twinkle original story called The Cautious Caterpillar. It was springtime in the garden. Cody the caterpillar hatched from her egg and crawled onto a big green leaf. She smiled happily. "I love being a caterpillar," she said, and began to eat her tasty leaf. Just then, a ladybird flew over. "You're very lucky," said the ladybird. "When you become a butterfly, you will have wings like me." "Flying looks very tiring," Cody said. "I wish I could stay a caterpillar forever." "Don't worry," said the ladybird. "Having wings is great. You can always stop for a rest." Cody smiled, but didn't feel sure. "Maybe one day," she said. She carried on eating, and the ladybird flew away. The next day, a bee buzzed over. "You're very lucky," said the bee. "When you become a butterfly, you will sip nectar like me." "I don't think I will like nectar," said Cody. "I wish I could stay a caterpillar forever." "Don't worry," said the bee. "Drinking nectar is great. It's ever so yummy." Cody smiled, but didn't feel sure. "Maybe one day," she said. She carried on eating, and the bee buzzed away. A few days later, a grasshopper jumped on over. "You're very lucky," said the grasshopper. "When you become a butterfly, you will have 6 legs, just like me." "But I like having 16 legs," said Cody. "I wish I could stay a caterpillar forever." "Don't worry," said the grasshopper. "Having 6 legs is great. There's plenty for landing on the ground." Cody smiled, but didn't feel sure. "Maybe one day," she said. She carried on eating, and the grasshopper jumped away. The next day, Cody was full. She thought about everything her friends had told her and decided to be brave. "Maybe today," she said, as she changed herself into a chrysalis. She stayed like that for many days until she was finally ready to leave her chrysalis and become a butterfly. Cody explored the garden, feeling happy and proud of her new wings. "Having wings is great," she said, as she flew past the ladybird. "This is yummy," she said to the bee as they sipped nectar together. 6 legs is plenty," said Cody, as she landed next to the grasshopper. That evening, she came across a caterpillar on a tasty green leaf. "You're very lucky," said Cody. "When you have finished eating, you'll become a butterfly, just like me." The caterpillar smiled, but didn't look sure. "I wish I could stay a caterpillar forever," he said. "Don't worry," said Cody. "I loved being a caterpillar too, but trust me, being a butterfly is great." Maybe you feel a bit like Cody the caterpillar as you think about going back to school. She was cautious, wasn't she? And that means scared or worried, a bit unsure or nervous, and not looking forward to change. She said that flying might be tiring, didn't she? And when told about the nectar, she was a bit negative at first and said, "I don't think I'll like it." She kept saying, "I wish I could stay a caterpillar forever." Maybe you feel a bit that way, that you wish things could stay the same and stay at home forever. But change can be good. Cody thought about everything her friends had told her, and she decided to be brave. When she took the plunge and became a butterfly, she felt excited and happy and proud and relieved. And she thought it was really great to fly. I'm sure you'll feel like that when you get back to school and you see your friends and you go to your new classroom and meet your new teacher. Don't forget, if you're worried at all, you can talk to the grown-ups in the classroom, can't you? You can talk to your friends. You can talk to your mum and dad as well. And they can all help you and reassure you. In the Bible, Jesus tells us not to be worried, that he doesn't want us to be worried. He says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. And do not be afraid." And lots of times he says, "Don't worry about tomorrow," and that he will be with us until the end of the age. And he'll be with us whatever we do, whatever we're going through, whatever situation. We can rely on God. And don't forget, we can always talk to God through prayer, can't we, to help us to get through situations. So as you enjoy the last few days of your holiday, have a really good time. And I look forward to seeing you again soon. Bye.
Good morning. I'm going to carry on our theme of four slices of the same pizza. Do you remember we were hanging our thoughts on that verse, Luke 2:52, that says that Jesus grew in wisdom, in stature, in favour with God and with man. And the idea being a kind of holistic growth, an integrated growth. That's what we're thinking about. That's the kind of roadmap we're looking on at this short series. And so today we're looking at the idea that Jesus grew in stature. And some people think that that word means to do with his reputation. And of course, in one sense, Jesus did kind of grow in his reputation. But actually, most of the translations, it's referring to his physical growth. The Good News talks about him growing in body. The Living Bible says that he grew taller. And like I say, most of the translations kind of, this is that idea of physical growth. When we think of the Christian calendar, you know, Christmas and Easter, there's just 3 or 4 months between those two events. But actually, in the life of Jesus, it was 33 years of growing, of developing. And so today we're going to kind of think a little bit about this whole theme of the body. We're going to look at what are some of the prevailing ideas today and in the past. What does the Bible have to say? Is there any action or we have to take an acceptance of ourselves, and also about our future hope? Okay. First of all, we need to say, don't we, when we think about the 21st century, just how much the body is kind of being elevated. You know, we live in this kind of Baywatch society, don't we, where image is everything. We, you know, you look at the magazines, the TV programs, the whole of media is geared up for the image. When we think of the Oscars, it kind of, I guess, just highlights it, doesn't it? Every February, the red carpet, and millions tune in to see who's wearing what and what shape they're in, and there's that whole thing of just looking at the outward appearance. Marilyn Monroe said this. She said that Hollywood is the place that will give you $1,000 for a kiss, 50 cents for your soul. Yeah. In the recent Super Bowl in America, I'm not an American football fan, but apparently the whole focus was not actually on the two teams who were playing, but on the 14-minute slot in the interval given to Shakira and Jennifer Lopez. It seems that image has conquered substance, doesn't it? And we again, like I say, we are aware over the last few years, you know, the rise of gymnasiums and fitness trainers and all those things. In one sense, that they're good, but they, when we elevate it, when we take that slice of the pizza and say that this is the most important thing, then it becomes an idol. And someone once said that when we suppress the truth about God, what we do is take something else and put it in God's place. And again, we're conscious, aren't we, in our image-driven society, the pressure that puts on, particularly on younger people. We, you know, that whole thing that you've got to be the perfect weight, size, shape, is incredible. We're just going to watch a quick video. Thank you. No wonder our perception of beauty is deceptive, said the video there. So I think there's one negative view of the body is when we, like I say, when we put it on a pedestal and it's the be and end all. Another negative view in the opposite is when we just say, well, it doesn't really matter. You know, we can treat our body how we want, doesn't matter what we eat, whether we do any exercise. And so we depreciate the body. We kind of say, well, it's not really important. I remember a number of years ago, many years ago, when I lived in Acton, I was looking pretty rough one day. I hadn't shaved and, you know, a bit disheveled. And I was coming down my road, and at the top of my road, there was this place that kind of gave out soup and stuff for people who either lived on the streets or were going through a rough time. And I remember this person coming out and saying, he called to me, he said, "Here, mate, come over here. You can get a nice bowl of soup and some new clothes if you want." And I said to him, no, it's okay, I'm all right, thanks, I just live down here. But obviously I hadn't really taken very good care of myself that particular day. It's interesting, in the 2nd, 3rd century, there was a group of people called the Gnostics. And they had this idea of kind of dividing up people into bits, yeah? And one of their ideas was this, is that they said that the spirit was good and the body was bad, yeah? And so the idea for them was to try and get the spirit to be kind of set free from the body. The body was a cage, it was matter, it was physical, and it was bad. And the whole goal of them was to release the spirit. So that's what they believed. It's interesting because some people might say, well, didn't Paul write something about that in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, where he said that, you know, this is a body's a tent, and it's much better to be away from the body and with the Lord. But I think we have to be careful when we read things like that, what Paul is saying. Paul is not saying that the body is evil or bad or not important. He's just saying, look, we've got a future hope, something better, and we'll come to that a bit later. Let's have a look about what the Bible actually does say about the body. It says this in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. It says, "Do you not know that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You were bought with a price. Therefore, honour God with your body." The celebrity chef, Anthony Bourdain, who committed suicide, he said this. He said that, "I've never seen my body as a temple, but rather as a fun house." And as one person commentated, they said, but the fun ran out and the house is now empty. People talk about, don't they, the idea of buildings being sacred. And I'm not going to kind of go into that kind of debate now, but there's this whole thing, isn't there, of particularly at these times, you know, we've heard of discussions of people wanting buildings opened so that people can go in and pray and. But the Bible says, look, our bodies are more sacred than any building. Yeah? They're where God's Spirit dwells. Yeah, and so for that reason, we need to treat our bodies. They're not our own. You know, we need to treat them with value and respect. Yeah, John, in his 3rd letter, he writes this in his opening statement. He says, "Dear friend, I pray that you may enjoy good health, and that everything may go well with you, even as your soul is getting along." So he's saying, you know, I hope you're well. I hope you're healthy, just as your soul is. He's not trying to split, but he's saying, I hope you're well. Paul, in his letter in Timothy, in chapter 4, he says, "Physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things." But he's saying, look, hey, it's okay, yeah. Let's talk a little bit about action and acceptance very quickly. I want to give you a Spanish word, okay? Chatarra. Chatarra, you think, oh yes, I know, it's one of those exotic little animals in the Amazon, the lesser spotted chatarra. Actually, it's a word that means junk food. And it's been interesting seeing the queues and queues of cars going up to the drive-through McDonald's. It seems that the new normal is the old normal. People are desperate for a Big Mac, or in terms of IKEA, for a flat pack. Yeah, but this is what people are living for. Just in case you're one of those people, I'm not having a go at you. But we know, don't we, that our diet is an important thing. You know, I love pizza. Yeah. And I love coffee cake, but I also recognize I need to eat fruit and salad and other stuff that is more healthy for me. And in terms of exercise, I'm just going to have a grumpy old man moment here. I can't stand, one of the things I've really hated, no, that's a strong word, but I can't, you know, those people who come on telly in their leotards or in their tracksuits, jumping up and down their lounges, telling us we've all got to exercise. I mean, as if we need anyone to tell us. And but we know, if we're physically, it's possible and feasible, we know that exercise is good for us, yeah? Physically, but also it helps us, I think, in our mind as well. We don't need someone to kind of, you know, tell us. What about our appearance? I'll give you a quote about someone, okay? A man small in size, with meeting eyebrows and a rather large nose, bald-headed. Sounds a bit like me, that, oh dear. No, bow-legged, strongly built, a description of who? You think, oh, it's not Tom Cruise. It was a description of Apostle Paul, yeah? And it goes on to say, full of grace, for at times he looked like a man and at times he had the face of an angel. Paul's physical appearance didn't matter, didn't it? His outward appearance, God was going to use him, because here was a person who just wanted to do God's will. Here was a person who just longed to live for God and serve him with all his being, all his energy, and had that incredible appetite. You know, for me to live is Christ, as we were reading in Philippians a few weeks ago. Yeah. So there comes a point, don't we, where we just need to accept who we are and what we look like. I've told this story before, but it's worth telling again. When I was teaching in one of the schools in Ecuador a few years ago, I was teaching, I don't know, kind of 7 or 8 year olds, and we were looking at adjectives, and I stood on this chair and said to the kids, okay, what am I? Always a dangerous question to ask kids. And one little girl, Dominica, she looked down at a book. I don't think she really understood English, and she saw this one word and she shouted out, ugly. I said, yeah, thanks, Dominica. And after 7 trips to the counsellors and, lonely walks along the beach, which is difficult in El Tingo because we haven't got a beach, I seem to, come to terms with it. But, there's that whole sense of just accepting ourselves, isn't it, and not get wound up about when we look in the mirror. Just lastly, we need to think a little bit about the kind of fallenness that we live in, the fallen world, but our future hope, yeah? All of us are, as the cliche says, we're not as young as we used to be, yeah? And we all have limitations, yeah? I remember playing football, my last competitive match again a few years ago, in a fantastic pitch it was. We've got a team called Independiente. They're in like the top division in Ecuador. A group of us managed to kind of borrow their pitch, and it was the dream to play on this pitch that looked like a bowling green. And there were 30 people in the stadium and a dog, and this was the moment, to shine. And I remember playing for in the first 15 minutes, I was running my heart out and making some darting runs. Well, to me, they were darting. And then all of a sudden, I just came to a stop, and embarrassingly had to signal to the manager on the side to take me off, because I just couldn't keep up the pace. I've just been doing some running recently, and along the seafront, and you know those steps, those of you know that Frinton-on-Sea, and there's some steps at Connell Avenue where it goes down to the beach, and I run along the promenade, and then I come back to these steps, and I look at these steps, and I I start running, well, moving up the steps. And as I'm going up the steps, I'm thinking about Rocky. Do you remember Rocky? If you've seen the film, I think it's the first film. And he runs up these steps in Philadelphia, I think it is. There's a kind of museum at the top. And as he goes up, there's got all the great background music, and he turns around and he goes like this. And it's a kind of iconic scene in cinema. And but as I go up the steps, I'm kind of huffing and puffing. I'm not touching the rails because you can't use the rails, and I get to the top and I can't even be bothered to turn around. I just kind of, saunter off across the greensward, and it's a pretty pathetic sight. And I'm conscious that, my body is not what it used to be a few years ago. We live, don't we, in this fallen world. There's some law, isn't there, that everything's winding down. Is that the... Yeah, there's some law that says that everything's winding down, and it's true in physically. But we have an incredible hope, don't we? Yeah. It's interesting because when we look at the life of Jesus, he was born as a baby in a manger in Bethlehem, spent his early years as a refugee in Egypt, came back to Nazareth, grew up in the teenage years into manhood in Nazareth, and then he finally he laid down his body on a cross for us. But as you know, that the story doesn't end there, doesn't it? 3 days later, he rose again. He triumphed in power, and with a resurrected body, and he appears to his disciples, and they can't believe it. And he says, "Give me something to eat." And they hand him some broiled fish, and he eats it in front of them. And there's just, the Bible says, isn't it, just as Jesus rose again, so we too, for all those who have faith and hope in him, will rise with him. Yeah. And this life is not the end. And one day we will not just be a disembodied spirit floating around, but we will have a new resurrected body. Yeah. For all of us who are feeling the aches and the pains, and those of us who can't get out, those of us who can't exercise or whatever, there is this promise, this hope, yeah, that we will have a new body. There will be no more queuing up at Boots, one in, one out for tablets or anything like that. No more trying to get hold of the doctor and press one for this or two for that or whatever. We have a new resurrected body. So just as we finish, I think we need to say this, don't we? On one hand, we must not idolize the body. We mustn't take it and put it on a pedestal that it's not. But also, even though it's not an idol, but our bodies are temples, temples of God's Spirit, and we need to look after them. Okay, there's much more we could have said on that, but time doesn't allow it. I hope you have a really good week. Okay, God bless. Take care. Thank you.
So that's it. Thank you for joining us today for this service. We hope it's been a blessing to you. Let's just close in prayer, shall we? Lord Jesus, I do thank you so much for technology. I thank you for the resources and the abilities that we have as a church. And Father, I just pray as this goes on YouTube and it can be viewed whenever, wherever, by whoever, I pray it would be a blessing to them as well, Father. And if other churches see this video, other churches that don't have the resources that we have and the manpower to produce this content, Father, I just pray that they will know that they can use this, and we just pray that it would be a blessing to them and their congregation too. But more importantly, Father, we pray it would be honouring to you. Amen. See you next week.